Alright, so after much deliberation, one more so-called secular or political or you know, just one of these topics we're gonna reason concerning the inability of the average American citizen not being able to accept that the foundations of this so-called great nation are those of secrecy. And honestly, we don't even feel comfortable speaking about these things because we only care about Ja word. But due to the gravity of the situation and the inertia preventing, you know, man to continue on and progress, you know, and thus establishing a better way of living for all within the human community, then it is our responsibility to have to at least take some time and share some knowledge concerning some of these worldly topics. So the topic for this reasoning will be secrecy in America. Since the beginning, America was founded on secrecy. They even teach you this in school, from elementary to junior high and high school. And now even, you know, some of those history channels and stuff like that. But it's well documented. It's a fact that this country was built on secrecy. What we'd like to point out, just the connection between secrecy and manipulation of media to manipulate groups or masses of people in instigating certain reactions that would benefit the purpose of a few. And we'd like to reason concerning the founding fathers, you know, whatever it is that people think that they found. Let us reason concerning that. Alright, so they all participated or were influenced by this so-called European awakening. But we must understand that in that time, Europe was in darkness, and it seems like if they saw a light, which turned out to be nothingness, so they came out of darkness into nothingness, pure vanity, thinking that man's intellect and reason was far beyond any other thought or belief or philosophy or idea or you know. So these so-called founding fathers were highly influenced by the whole movement of nothingness, you know, the illumination from darkness to nothingness that was taking place in Europe at that time. And and in taking on those ideas, it became kind of like their groundation or their foundation, in which if the happenings are not self-evident, then it cannot be. If man's reasoning is not able to understand or comprehend it, or man's reason logically explain it, then it cannot be. So that's we just have to set that for the record. This is the mentality of these individuals coming over to so-called New World, right? Funny how that kind of passed their logic, right? How it was self-evident that this was not a new world, right? But like we said, they keep certain things secret, and other things they ignore, and other things, you know, they pretend them to be when they're in truth not. So going forward, one of these individuals, so-called illuminated with nothingness, taken out of darkness, led into nothingness, was Benjamin Franklin. Benjamin Franklin came from Europe, and he is an interesting character. But what we just want to point out is his affiliation with these secret societies, so-called whatever, it's well known. But so he was established, basically, is what we're trying to say. He had a printing press. He was in control of a printing press, whether it was completely his or we really can't recall. But as far as we remember, he had a printing press. He was an owner of a printing press, and so in one of his trips over to Europe, he is confronted with this individual whom has a writing style that Benjamin Franklin just falls in a trance with, and so he convinces Thomas Paine, which is this writer that we speak of, to come to the colonies, and he pretty much, I don't know what he did, but he convinced them to go over. So Thomas Paine is shipped over along with Benjamin Franklin over to the colonies, and this is a perfect union for, these secret groups that have secret plans to bring about their own personal interest, and thus benefit from it. The union between these two individuals ended up in they resulted in events such as the Boston Massacre, which is the only example that we want to bring forth, because it's the only one that we're 100% sure that the happenings took place the way in which we are gonna get into just now. So there's like a little skirmish that's taking place in Boston, kind of like a mishap. We weren't there, honestly, but some of the British soldiers, they get a little out of hand, right? And there's kind of like a somewhat of a we don't even know how to put it. There's some drama taking place at one of these ports in Boston. Benjamin Franklin, being as clever as he is, as he was, excuse me, he decides to have Thomas Paine blow that little, little drama scene, that little mishap that took place, blow it way out of proportion, and use it in Thomas Paine's writing to instigate, or at least to use as fuel for the fire, and eventually bring about the revolution. So this is one of the many ways in which a few instigated their own personal purpose upon the general population, that they may go along with this so-called idea of liberation, and thus, bring about the purpose of a few, and sacrificing the general population, that their own selfish interests may be attained, right? So, and this happened all throughout the instigation leading up to the rebellion, to the revolution. And this isn't a conspiracy theory. It's not like make believe. It's what it is. Thomas Paine, being highly encouraged by Benjamin Franklin, turns out, results in writing what they call the pamphlets, Common Sense, another form of instigation, adding fuel to the fire purposely, that their secret agenda may be carried out and put into play, into practice, and execute as they actually did, right? And there's all kinds of evidence. All these individuals had to do with these secret societies, whatever. There's even much information on how Benjamin Franklin, being the ambassador to France, and Thomas Jefferson, how they actually instigated the French Revolution. And we wouldn't be surprised if they had to do with all the revolutions. As we know, the CIA has to do with every single revolution that has taken place all throughout the Americas, right? And so whenever a good president or a good leader rises amongst a indigenous people, or just poor people considered less by these so-called superiors, whenever a character of that type arises, then that kind of interferes with the business of these corporate superior beings, so-called. And so it is up to them to go break that off, Whenever a country wants to become independent and work for their own people and sustain themselves and stuff like that, that means death to American corporatism and all that fascism. And so it's been done, you know, over and over and over throughout the centuries. But nonetheless, back to the main topic, or forward to the back to the, forward, excuse me, forward to the main topic. So should we conclude there? The secret societies, all of the, yeah, I think that's pretty much just what we wanted to make mention. This ain't no, okay, one last note. All these individuals were not Christian at all. I mean, Thomas Jefferson, there's this so-called Jefferson Bible that he put out. He's completely, he actually agrees with the parts of the gospel where nothing spiritual takes place, but he mostly discredits everything else. He says that there's like a few places where Jesus the man was an actually, you know, a man of morals, and you know, they actually considered that part, like the few parts that had nothing spiritual within them, for they cannot receive anything spiritual, them being natural men, and so they accepted those small verse or those few verses as a exemplary character, we could say, but they pretty much discredited everything else and saw it foolishness and thought that anyone who could possibly accept this as true was completely insane, as Thomas Paine thought that the writer of Revelations was the writings of a madman. And so these people were hardcore anti-Christians to the fullness. I mean, Thomas Paine, this guy's hardcore, and to be honest, personally, I, Alonso, like, there's somewhat of a respect, not in the sense that we revere this individual, but you know, he died strong at will. You know, he was down to be an antichrist, is what we're trying to say. This individual was scared of being alone, not because he was scared of any other thing, but the fact that there was fanatic Christian after fanatic Christian going up to him, because he was sick, right? He's sick, and so he's in his bed, and people know that he's kind of about to die. And this individual, Thomas Paine, was so rooted with this anti-Christianity that he feared that one of these fascist Christians might run out after his passing and lie to the people saying that he repented and accepted Jesus Christos as his salvation. He made sure that there was always more than three witnesses to testify to the fact that he died as an antichrist, completely refusing the whole Christian. To him, it was a foolishness, right? But nonetheless, it's recorded that there was 20 witnesses, and they all confirmed that he took that to the death and did not repent. He wanted to make sure that the world knew that he was not for Christ and completely against it. So, you know, this individual was down for what he believed. I mean, at least he was, you know, as far as we could say, you know, at least he took it to the grave. You know, he must have really believed it. So that's kind of like, we thought that was a funny story anyways. But yeah, we'll conclude with that. Shalom Rastafari.